Hello, hello. It's Sonny Melendrez, and welcome to the Sonny Melendrez Podcast. Can you see the smile on my face? We just found out, this is big news, just found out from iTunes that this is one of the fastest growing podcasts on iTunes and the web. That's right. Between last week and this week, our growth has been phenomenal. We started out with one listener. Now we have 11. Now, if you do the math, that's over 1,000%. 1,000% in 1 week. So look out and thank you. Thank you for making us as popular as we are. All right. The theme for this episode is paying it backward. Now, let me explain. When I first arrived in Los Angeles in the 1970s, there were two people that I wanted to meet. They were people that I looked up to as a kid and growing up and, of course, becoming a broadcaster myself. And these two people were incredibly busy, very popular, at the top of their game. When I told people at the station, KMPC, where I did my show, I explained to them, I said, I've got to meet them. Can anybody help me? Well, nobody could, but not only did they said that they couldn't, they discouraged me. They said, you're not going to get to talk to them. You know, they're so busy. They got so many different, you know, assistants and producers, and you're just not going to. Well, that did not deter me. So I picked up the phone, and I called Dick Clark Productions and asked to speak to Dick Clark. And I don't know how it happened, but there he was on the phone. And so I asked if I could, I think I stumbled through the conversation, but I asked if he could give me like 30 minutes of his time for an interview. And he said, absolutely. And we set up a date. And so I showed up at Dick Clark Productions, which was on Sunset Boulevard at the time. And I came in a little early. And I have to tell you, Dick was always, always one of my idols. What I loved about Dick Clark was that he created his own opportunities with American Bandstand, which he created. And then, of course, it grew to all kinds of other shows, national television shows. So he didn't wait around for somebody to hire him. He hired himself. And he worked his magic on both sides of the microphone and both sides of the camera. Just an amazing, amazing human being. And I had to meet him and find out more about how it was that he got there. So I'm sitting there in the lobby, kind of nervous, but excited. And the assistant comes out and says, Dick will see you now. And I go back to his office, and it was filled with all kinds of great memorabilia and pictures. And it was like being in a museum. So half an hour turned into an hour, and over 2.5 hours later, I was leaving with my feet not even touching the ground. And over the years in radio at various stations, Dick has been a gracious guest. So what you're about to hear is one of the many conversations I had with Dick Clark. I'm going to take you back to, I want to say, the summer of 1980. And interesting to hear now what he said back then about the future of rock, about various singers, some of whom are no longer with us, and about something called disco. Here's my conversation with Dick Clark. This is Sonny Melendrez on Weekend LA, and I'm not going to introduce him as the world's oldest teenager. I'll say he's the world's youngest adult. Hello, Dick Clark.
You've improved on the already well-polished phrase. The only one word you missed there, Sonny. I can never get anybody to say America's oldest living teenager. Oldest living Civil War veteran. It's a wonderful phrase that somebody in a magazine wrote once. I'm sure they thought they were going to hurt my feelings, and it's turned out to be a trademark.
That is funny. America's oldest living.
It's a funny little twist. And anyway, it's nice to be with you again.
Oh, nice to talk to you. I tell you, I read your introduction to Norman Knight's book. You know, he wrote the final definitive book on rock and roll as far as where those people are.
and getting all the information that he has garnered over the years. And I'm just waiting for you to come up with your Reflections of Rock and Roll by Dick Clark.
Well, you know, actually, that's in the works. There is a book coming out in the spring of next year, which is an encyclopedia sort of thing, that is a serious study of the subject. I wrote a book a long time ago that was my personal recollections and reflections, sort of autobiographical. But this next thing, the silver anniversary of rock and roll, I did in conjunction with a couple of researchers, and it's a pretty good book.
I can think of no one else better to do something like that than Dick Clark.
He's got a lot of pictures and information. Norm is the best in the field. I mean, he is into who was the third lead singer of the Drifters in the 19th version of whatever, you know.
Right.
He has the trivia down. He's writing another one, too. I just met with him a couple of weeks ago. He's the guy who inspired me to write my own book. You have to be a peculiar breed of dog, though, to get into it as deeply as Norm has.
Oh, yeah, and it's a full-time job.
Oh, absolutely.
And, of course, we know that you need the work, so you have nothing else better to do.
My problem is, I walk into a room or a party or a bar somewhere, and somebody will say to me, all right, there, you know all this stuff. Who was the first singer that stood on his head in Japan and ported flip-flop? You know, I don't know any of these.
You know, there's something I do want to ask you, because I know you keep tabs with a lot of the people from rock and people that you've gave it. You had a lot to do with their careers. Whatever happened to Gene Pitney?
Gene Pitney lives in Connecticut. He works primarily in England. I haven't been able to convince him to go on the road or do any of our good old rock and roll extravaganzas. I wish he would. I think he's a giant talent, but I think probably he is. Found an area and he's just taking it easy.
Oh, I can imagine.
What's wrong with that?
There are people like that whose styles back then would fare well today. Look at Roy Orbison.
Oh, I mean,
you've got to be thrilled
about
that.
Voice quality of Roy, of Gene Pitney, Del Shannon had a voice that lasted. I mean, the whole world has turned around, especially now with the Barry Manilows coming in and Sadaka's doing very well.
Sure.
An area there.
Whatever happened to Bobby Rydell?
Bobby Rydell lives in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. He works at the Catskills, Florida, the eastern part of the country. He's a nightclub singer. He does very well.
Connie Francis?
Connie Francis has just cut a new album. She's had great difficulty getting her head together. She had a lot of personal tragedy lately. And the last few years, unsuccessful marriages. As you know, she had a very bad experience with a rape case in a motel, which destroyed her head for a while, but emotionally she's now got herself together and she's making records, and my next stage is to convince her to come back on the stage.
Good for you. What about Brenda Lee, Dick?
Brenda Lee is doing well in country. She lives in Nashville with her husband and doesn't do many of the good old rock and roll things, but she does. She just recently had a big hit record in country.
Have you seen our mutual friend Robert Thomas Baleen lately?
Yeah, Bobby V has returned to his roots. He's opening a guitar store in
I'll be darned.
Kona, St. Cloud, Minnesota, and settling down with his wife and family. He does occasionally go out and do the oldies but goodies shows, but he's now primarily a music retailer.
Well, now, speaking of oldies but goodies shows, you have a review that you take all over the country that is coming to the Los Angeles County Fair October 1st and 2nd. And who will be on that review, Dick?
Well, this is a show, Sonny, that we do in Las Vegas, Reno, Tahoe, state fairs, amusement parks. We've broken a lot of substantial records, and this is one of our last engagements, and it's going to be here close to home with Bo Diddley, the Coasters, and Freddie Cannon.
Why do you say one of your last engagements?
Well, we do most of these in the summertime. Summer seems to be a good time for good old rock and roll, so we're going to wind up here close to home, and then we probably won't start again until the spring.
Oh, I see. Last for this year.
Oh, yeah.
All right. But you've got Freddie Cannon, the Coasters, and Bo Diddley.
Oh,
does he just still do that thing on stage with his guitar? Does he still wear it way down low?
In the introduction, I think, Sonny, I say it, and I'll probably say the same thing if you come to the L.A. County Fair. There have been a lot of people who claim to be the father of rock and roll. There is no one person. There are a lot of them. But this man designed a guitar and made sounds, and when they came out of it, they were so unusual there probably wouldn't have been a Jimi Hendrix or a George Harrison or an Eric Clapton or a Peter Townsend. He influenced more guitar players than practically any other human being. Then he created a beat that's his trademark, and he's just as good today as he was a quarter of a century ago when he started.
Oh, I can imagine. And Freddie Cannon, does he sing Palisades Park?
He does Palisades Park and Way Down Yonder, New Orleans, and Where the Action Is, and he probably is the one single individual I know who can get a total audience standing on its head in about 5 minutes.
I love it. Do the Coasters, are they the original group? How many are left?
No, there have been several cast changes in there. Bobby Nunn is one of the original guys. You know, the Robins years ago started out here, and the West Coast was the thing that gave them the name, the Coasters. Lieber and Stoller's music is timeless, and these guys are phenomenal. Their harmonies and the memories that they bring back are, you know, I watch them every night, and it astounds me. It seems like they're doing it for the first time, and you know that's not true. They've done it a few thousand times.
Absolutely. You know, Dick, the current hit by Billy Joel, It's Still Rock and Roll to Me. How do you feel about that? Do you feel that rock has really changed? Are we going back to the beginnings of rock and roll? What's happening?
Well, I think the roots of the music are very important these days. I think all of life today is striving to be simpler. The 1980s may well prove to be the second time around for the 1950s, Sonny, and perhaps that's the reason that good old rock and roll is wheeling along so well these days.
I asked you this about 2 years ago, and I want to ask you again. What's in the cards for disco?
Well, I think the lifestyle is with us for many, many years. It's based primarily on people meeting people. Disco as a form of music is in the complete doldrums now. It's almost like an illegal word. People just overdosed on disco, but the dancing hasn't stopped, nor has the places to go and the dressing up and all of that. The lifestyle's still with us.
Yeah. It's amazing how your suits have worn well over the years.
I don't try to be a chameleon. I couldn't possibly look like the people I hang around
with. I love it. Well, listen, Dick, we look forward to seeing you at the L.A. County Fair October 1st and 2nd. Two big shows on the 1st and then another one on the 2nd. And with Freddie Cannon, the Coasters, and Bo Diddley.
You'll have fun, Sonny, and thanks again. It's always nice to be with you.
Same here. Thank you, Dick Clark.
Right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Now, that's a man and a memory that I will never forget. The late, great Dick Clark. And I'll tell you how gracious he was. He invited me to come out to the dress rehearsal of the American Music Awards. So I was able to meet and interview many of the big stars, including Aretha Franklin, Stevie Wonder, Smokey Robinson. It was unbelievable. In fact, you'll see a picture that we took in front of the Santa Monica Civic that kind of gives you an idea of what we looked like back then and how we dressed. And I promise you, I did not call Dick and say, what are you going to wear? But it was just that we wore the style of the time. And you'll see that on the show notes. All right, the other incredible icon that I wanted to meet was someone whose show we used to play when I was program director of a small station, KINT, in El Paso, and then later at KTSA in San Antonio. And on the weekends, we played a show called American Top 40. It was probably the most popular and most listened to syndicated music show in the world. And I used to think to myself, this guy has got the best job ever. He gets to tell stories about all these great artists and present the most popular songs in America. Of course, I'm talking about Casey Kasem. And I can still hear his voice. Hi, this is Casey Kasem, counting down the hits in all the land. Wow, what a signature voice that was. So when I found his number, somehow, somebody gave it to me, I called him. And he answered. And when you're talking to Casey Kasem on the phone, it's surreal because you're listening to this voice that you've heard all these years. And it's so funny because I'm in radio. People have told me this, but as a fan, I'm listening to Casey's voice and just, you know, having a great conversation. The nicest guy. Turns out he listened to my show on the radio in L.A., and I invited him to come on the show, and sure enough, he did. And then about a year later, as we'd had conversations back and forth, he called me it was actually on a weekend, and he said that he was going on vacation. In fact, he calls, he says, hey, Sonny, it's Casey. Like he needed to tell me who he was. And he said he was going on vacation in a couple of weeks and wanted to know if I would sit in for him. Can you imagine what I must have felt when he said that? And I, of course, very professionally said, oh, I'd be happy to. No, absolutely. When would you like me to do this? So 2 weeks later, I'm at the Watermark Studios, the home of American Top 40, and I'm sitting behind that iconic microphone, broadcasting to hundreds of stations around the world as I sat in for Casey Kasem.
Hi, and welcome to American Top 40. I'm Sonny Melendrez, sitting in for Casey Kasem, who's on vacation this week. And while Casey's working on his tan, I'll be counting down the 40 most popular songs in America for you. We've got four debut songs in the survey, hits by some of the biggest and most important recording artists in the business, and a brand new number one song. A lot of chart action and a lot of great music. So let's get the countdown rolling right here with the first of our debuts.
Number 40!
Well, this is the first Top 40 record in 4 years by one of the biggest groups of the rock era. Their last hit was Automatically Sunshine back in 72. This week, the Supremes debut in the anchor position on American Top 40 with their latest, I'm Gonna Let My Heart Do the Walking.
So there you go. Two unbelievable giants in the world of broadcasting. Dick Clark and Casey Kasem. Paying attention to some kid who just wanted to know what it was like and how they got there and be inspired by their stories. It's been said that the ladder of success is one arm stretched up to someone who's willing to help you while you use your other arm to pull someone else up to where you are. May we continue to pay it forward and backward. With that, I'm Sonny Melendrez. Thank you for listening. See you next time. Bye-bye.